Hello there, everyone. Welcome to a brand new series that I am happy to get started on. This series I'm going to be calling 1 Week to Kill, where I'm going to bring to you a look at all the free-to-play games that we have available to us there, dive into them for about a week's time, roughly, and to give you the results on how progression goes. Basically, we are going to be looking into the free-to-play games there, how easy it is to get into the grind involved with them for a free-to-play game there, because almost all of them incorporate some form of microtransaction of some sort there. How your rate of progression is going to go, and basically witness the result of the time and hours that I put into it within a week's time. So you can have at least a rough sense on how far along you're going to be with the time that you invest. At least with the starting portion of these games. And for my pilot episode, my very first episode there, I am going to bring to you Guild Wars 2. Which, if you have not actually been paying attention to Guild Wars, they actually announced last week, as I was starting up this series, that it was going to be free to play, up to like level 60 or level 80, I believe. At least the original version there, leading up to where its expansion is at, which is going to be released later this month. So this game was just screaming, just begging to be done for like my initial episode. This is 1 Week to Kill, and I am going to dive in this game, mainly on the PvP portion, but I played a fair amount of the PvE to take a look at the story, the crafting, all the other stuff that an MMO game of its type, massive multiplayer type of online game. So we're going to have a look at this. We're going to have some fun with it, and I'm going to talk to you about the basics and the concepts of the game, as well as talk about all that you can do in this game, essentially. So you can judge if this game is worth your time, especially since most multiplayer games is going to be a long-term investment there, but have a look, see if the story is compelling, the mechanics into the game is enjoyable, should be, and be able to keep you into the game long enough to reach max level in the end game portion, because pretty much the main theme of all of these MMO games is that their end game is supposed to be their strong point to kind of keep you playing there from there on out, because otherwise the progression can be fun to an extent, but once you reach the very end where there's no more leveling, no more gear, no more skills to acquire, what keeps you going there? But this is basically Guild Wars 2 in a nutshell here. I'm basically inside what I believe is the capital city for my faction here. There have been about 5 different races there. I'm basically what they call the Char, and if you play Guild Wars 1, you probably recognize these as probably the main antagonists for like the very beginning of the storyline there. So I just started off here to at least get a good sense of the scale the game has to offer there. It is a traditional MMO in that sense, though. It is lots of like little mechanics that try and give you lots of different things to do, like usual items, limited item space there, item bank space. We got like talent points in this form of like acquiring skills. In this case, you have multiple different skills there, which you can use for your abilities down below. The more you unlock, the more variety you have to choose from. And down here, specializations are basically your talent trees, although I have yet to unlock them, but I can show you that in a moment's time. Because the one interesting thing about Guild Wars 2, which I don't know if many other MMOs are utilizing this method now, is if you decide to do PvP stuff, you immediately go to max level, and you unlock all your talents and abilities there, so I can show you that later on. But I'm going to cover some of the basics here, which of course is the like standard leveling route if you want to just do the standard like RPG style rather than the PvP. So we have our, like all MMOs, there's a form of crafting sense here. In this case, I'm just going to look at the chef vendor since I already actually got that established. You can only have access to, what is it, 2 different crafting trees, I believe. And there's like maybe 10 or 11 of them to have access to. In this case, I took weaponsmith, which I've yet to train there, but you got a large variety of stuff to go through for. And of course there's armorsmith, there's like a large variety there for almost everything you want. once you get into the nuance of it, but I took Weaponsmith and the Chef there. You only have access to two that you can get. If you want to get access to the other ones, you're going to have to drop one of them. So, standard limitations of most MMOs, I believe. Can't have access to everything, but you can at least try and cover the main things that you want with your character. In this case, I spent some time to craft up my chef there, level it up there, got some food, which basically gives you buffs of sorts. And of course, it gives you other benefits as well. Like, let's see, this has a chance to remove like a debuff or condition they call it, whatever you use skills. We have other traits. And of course, crafting materials for even more sophisticated type of food. So a lot of this is based on buffing, looks like dyes as well, to kind of color your armor, in a sense. And we have a few other items. And from what I understand, I leveled it up a little bit here, but as you level up, you just automatically gain new recipes, I believe. Of course, I'm sure there's others that you can get in the world or like buying there, but you don't need to constantly go back to your like trainer to kind of learn new recipes, unless you want to get to like specialized type of stuff. If there's even any recipes here, I don't see any. The only thing about the crafting recipes here is you actually have to buy like the harvesting equipments there, and they have a certain number of use there, so you're gonna find yourself stockpiling these, which I kind of would prefer just having one item there that you never have to go back to, unless you want to get a better quality item. In this case, you have to constantly go back to kind of get access to everything. But otherwise, this is the gist of the capital city there. You got your auction house, which is this train post, weaponsmith. You got a bunch of different things for like every type of player. Like these vistas here is kind of like a completionist type of thing. They're like in awkward places that you have to kind of navigate the terrain to get to, but if you get to them, you get like a nice scenic view of the region, a cinematic type of video. And of course, it contributes towards your achievements.
I've been watching the Ferrara Cubs train.
You have these waypoints here, which are basically
today.
Like your flight points. Which are basically like your flight point there, essentially. You can just double-click on these to instantly teleport to them. Most of them are free charge, but out in the leveling region, they do cost a little bit of income. And what else is there? There's a few other things. Let's see, those are elevators, teleporters.
No free samples.
And a bunch of other merchants. Let's see, ramp. And those are undiscovered points, so... Repair vendor, all of this pretty straightforward. Commander trainer, I'm not sure what that is. I haven't actually been to the commander trainer yet, so I can't comment too much on that. But everything here is pretty generic, what you expect from most massive multiplayer games if you ever played. But let's dive into the PvE element, shall we? Actually, yeah, I think I can get on the like story side of the quest. Like every 10 levels you get like a personal story type of quest line that you get like a short chain. Like in this case, it talks about my story here a little bit, as well as some higher level tier. I believe this is like end game type of stuff it shows, so yeah. And apparently that's part of their, that looks like that is part of their microtransaction system. It looks like some of these side stories are only available to you if you buy them. So unless you can buy it right away, I'm not sure what if that's a different way to unlock it, or you have to buy it before you can play it. I'm not entirely certain on that. But it looks like it limits some stories to you there. In this case, this is my story here. I only did like the first part here, I believe. Yeah, most recently activated series, so I don't think, yeah, that's activatable at level 20. So every 10 levels you get a new story arc that continues your character's storyline there. In this case, I don't want to spoil too much there, but when you create your character, you get to choose like a kind of like backstory a little bit, and it starts to develop here. In this case, I am part of the Blood Legion here, which is like the very aggressive type of char. They go into the fighting there, where there's like the Ash Legion, which I believe are the engineers, as well as like a rogue type of organization for a char, which will alter your storyline a little bit. And I believe that will technically affect how your own personal story how you go through it there. At least the first portion of it. I don't know if it affects the later portions or not. But this is the world PvE. It seems pretty straightforward there, because what you expect there, you have to roam around there, explore different regions, and try and level up your character to as high as you can pretty much get in the region. If you were to go to like lower level regions, you can actually do those as well, but it will level lower down your level there in that case. Like, if I were to go to a starting region, I'd be like level 3 or 4. It'll have like a little number on the side, which I am currently level 16. So everything is pretty straightforward here. The combat, I actually enjoy the combat quite a bit. Like, in this case here, I only have like a small handful of abilities here. In this case, I'm using a great axe or great sword, and what the skill traits is like here. You have like these past your like class specific abilities over on the right here, which are their own separate tree. Like in this case, like I showed you the talents and such here, which as you unlock them, you gain access to these abilities, and all of them are like different type of traits. Like in this case, these are considered utility skills, which I have access to here. Most of them are not unlocked yet because you have to use that for like the talent traits I just showed. And then you have your main skill, which is categorized as your healing skill, kind of for survivability. And here, which is unlocked in level 31, is what they call your elite skill, which is a really powerful, like, long cooldown, 3-4 minute type of cooldown ability in most cases. And over on the left here is all your weapon skills, which, from what the unique thing I like so far about Guild Wars 2 is it's based on your weapons, essentially. So if I swap my weapons, all the skills change completely to accommodate what weapon you have, or even the class that you're using, of course. Like, if I were to use a greatsword, it's this, like, paladin class there. They call it a guardian. It's technically like a holy knight, a paladin there. All these abilities are going to be different from any other class that essentially use a greatsword. So there's going to be a little bit of variation there. And I'm just going to roam around and just show you how the questing element works, because instead of, like, the traditional, like, pick up like an explanation point character, talk to him, they pick up quests. All the quests are like in regions areas, like in this case. Like, this heart symbol basically insinuates like a questing area, essentially, where you have to unlock a region here. In this case, let's see, it keeps track of everything, and let's see, repair drilling machines, detonate rock piles, slay dredge, and collapse holes. And the tunnels they poured in. So, instead of like picking up a quest in traditional, you just stay in this area and do what the objective asks for you, which has different varieties. Which is a nice fresh breath of fresh air, which allows you to like do multiple things to your liking, which is something most MMOs are starting to improve on. And another little feature, it doesn't say up here because it's pretty generic, is that you can revive like fellow friendly members, whether they're players or just NPCs in general. And it'll also boost your progress as well. So you got lots of multiple different ways, so long as the region itself is well developed, of course, because some quests can be more diverse and have a lot of different ways to complete there, others can be more generic, so it is basically based on the quest design. And this is like probably the main way you kind of level up your character, because when this bar fills up and is complete, you get a bunch of XP, you get a bunch of currency, which is called karma, which you can use for like specialized type of vendor gear, which I'll show you there once I talk to this character, although I think I need to actually complete this unlock that character though, so it may not work out. But you got your traditional type of you got your traditional type of currency. You got your coins here. Karma is like another currency here. And that's experience. So I finished just complete there, even though I wasn't intending to contribute to it there. I actually got like a bronze ring. So I guess for killing some of the characters and resing some of the miners or reviving them. So I'm trying to get this done as quickly as possible without burning up too much time. I may have to pass on so far, but let me see if can I actually talk to this vendor to show. There's a regular merchant there, but I want to kind of show that.
Need something.
Can't show the karma vendor, which you could buy more specialized type of equipment essentially. But of course, like copper net, you can just buy for regular like craftable stuff, expendable items like food, potions, and all that. And more specialized stuff you can use karma for essentially. So I think I'm done here. What I'm going to do is actually, since I have 4 tomes of knowledge, I can actually, this is mainly I get from like PvP, which I've been using, so I can, I'm gonna use these to level myself up to level 20 quickly. Because it's a nice convenient way to show you the, quickly show you some of the storyline. Hopefully it doesn't spoil too much there for like the, anyone who's interested in the char. So I'm gonna boost it up there. It's gonna unlock my storyline. It even shows a rundown for each one that you level up, and you get the choice of rewards. In this case, I get shoulders, so I want something power, so I'm gonna take that. And since I level up 4 times, I'm gonna have to use it. Okay, die. That's like for cosmetic stuff, so that's not too exciting there. Asura Gates, it unlocks that, which I haven't been able to use yet. Allows you to quickly travel. Okay, it allows you to travel to other major cities, essentially, so that's been unlocked. More hero points, which is basically my talent points, and my third utility slot's now unlocked, so I could put a new ability there if I wish. And like I said, level 31 will unlock the elite skill. And level 20, as I said, let's see, personal story 2, we get access to rings, jumping puzzles, that doesn't sound promising. And I also get access to my first ring that I can actually equip. And let's see, specialization is level 21, so I don't actually have my specialization talent just yet to show in-game here, but let's see, up here I have my unspent talent points. You basically just go through the trees there, or if you want to save them up for like the specializations down here. You can invest points to unlock the first skill, and when you do that, it unlocks the next skill, which either costs more or costs the same amount. In this case, they're all about the same. And alright, this is basically all upgrade, but the reason this is locked is because that's an elite skill there. So renewed focus, it makes me invulnerable for 3 seconds and recharges my virtues, which are actually what it says down here, my F1, F2, and F3, these are my virtues. Which are technically unique to this class, essentially, because every class has like different type of trait up here, which would be categorized as their F1, F5 kind of abilities. In this case, they're called virtues, which have a passive effect, but I can activate them to like trigger a more potent effect. And what that would do is just refresh them for me, since they have a cooldown after I activate them. But that's the talent system here. I'm gonna go straight. Is there a way? Straight to the storyline. If let me see where that is. So I'm gonna go to that there just to quickly show you briefly the storyline, because I've actually been enjoying that so far. The world type of experience gathering there is pretty generic, but it is a nice little different take on it there, essentially. Being able to not have to do quests and just roam around and just to wherever you like there, level permitting there, even if lower level region, and just complete all those areas there, find like other scenic areas, because they give you experience as well to a certain extent. But I imagine, was it, doing that questing region there just is probably the best way to get experience, so we'll see what the storyline is. There might be a little bit of spoilers, so give you early warning. If this does interest you.
Legionnaire. Glad you could make it. I've got some news I wanted to deliver to you personally.
And we'll see how this looks.
More problems, soldier. Your father, Valus Smokemane, has gone AWOL. He disobeyed direct orders, stole from the High Legions, and abandoned his warband. My father was a loose cannon sometimes, but betraying the Legions? That doesn't sound like him. That may be, but he ran off with a powerful idol his warband was guarding. It has magic linked to the human god Balthazar. If it falls into the wrong hands, it'll complicate our peace talks with the humans. Emmer Whipmane, your father's legionnaire, has always clashed with him. I can't trust her report, but with you in the field, I can get a more informed opinion. He is your father, after all.
To be clear, I don't know my father very well, but I'll do what I can, sir.
Good. Start with the main warband in Human's Lament. Pick up Valus's trail, track him down, and bring him in. Alive. Dismissed.
Okay, like I said, a little bit of spoiler since this is related to your father, I guess, which is something I wasn't aware of. So it basically, when you do these storyline areas, they kind of put you in your own like in private server, essentially, there. That's why I'm getting this exit there, so no other players can get involved with this unless I guess they're in my party. I actually have not experimented with that, so I've been basically playing the solo for a lot of this, so my experience is pretty much this, the solo perspective, essentially. I don't know how well this functions as far as, like, a group. But I'm back in the open world there. It gives you an objective for to continue on with the storyline, if you like. So in this case, it takes me all the way over there. That little portal just indicates a nice little... In this case, it just shows a teleport region there. Like, that would take me over here. If I wanted to go to the portal owner, I can just use these waypoints to kind of, like, get there quicker. But I have a bit of travel there. So, I've been enjoying the personal storyline quite a bit there. I don't know how much it varies for Char, like I said, but with different legions than that, it probably varies in at least the starting portion. The later on one, though, I'm pretty certain it converges from there on out. But the real fun for me personally is the PvP portion that I've been spending quite a bit of good time with. I spent almost as much time in the PvP as I have with the PvE, so... And this is where I got all those tombs of experience. So this is the PvP region here, and like I said, it automatically boosts you up to max level 40, or 80 rather, from what I understand. Let's see, does it even show on... Can I even target myself to show? Everyone should be level 80 as far as level experience and such. Let's see, does it show on here? Effective level 80, there we go. I'm level 20 for the PvE and world aspect there, but this is the PvP portion, and it is pretty straightforward. Because how the PvP works, this is your gear right here. Your weapons don't actually loot, are stripped of all their stats, essentially. You have access to sigils here, which you get a handful by default, which give you like bonuses and such, like 50% chance on a critical hit to do lightning strike. Same with this fire here, air, and blood to steal health. So the only way you can get stats, essentially, yeah, it says PvE uses normalized equipment attributes. So use your inventory equipment panel to view item details. So if you want to see stats or items, you have to go to the inventory. Here, it shows nothing. So the only way to get your stats are with these two items here. Which you have Rune the Pack, or these runes, basically, which give you, like... They're basically one item piece that gives you, like... They traditionally give you, like, set bonuses, but you do it in a single piece for purposes of PvP. Otherwise, for world PvP, you have to collect several of these, I guess, to get, like, set bonuses. But that's technically what you're looking at here. It unlocks all your set bonuses with a single rune. Essentially for PvP. And then you have your choice of an amulet there, which gives you a massive boost to your stats, essentially. So, basically to accommodate your playstyle and such. So that is basically all there is to PvP. It is quite overwhelming at first there, especially if you get in there really early, because it unlocks everything for you. Everything is unlocked. Like, the towns here I unlocked before are now available to me. So, you have to... Really learn your class there to kind of find optimal status. But an easy way to get started is, of course, find the weapons that you like there and just basically stick with one weapon for the time being so you can start to learn that bit by bit. And then you even got like different regions where you can practice here. Like over here is like NPCs, like minions that you can fight in actual like PvP battleground regions there. So that's where this is. Up here is where you can practice against specific classes there. Like, you got all the different classes to fight against. Here's like 8 different classes, a 9th one being introduced in the expansion there that you'll be fighting against. I haven't been inside this room, so I don't know what that brings. Over here is siege weapons, where there are actual siege weapons in some of these battlegrounds, so you can practice them in here. And then pretty much scattered all over the place, but over here is where there's a lot of them. You can get test dummies to practice comboing your abilities together, essentially. So, that is pretty much all this PvP world has to offer. You can duel against other players as well. Again, the gear does not matter, so you are kind of on equal footing. It's just a matter of learning your opponents and abilities, as well as learning your own abilities. And then, of course, all the stats are boosted up as well to accommodate. And you can just practice as you would like. These train dummies are basically to kind of optimize your combos and abilities. So let's get into a quick PvP game, shall we? Like, let's see. the main incentive to actually do PvP aside for like just straight up the actual PvP fighting itself, there is you get a lot of these like different, like they're pretty much weeklies, I guess. In this case, it looks like it almost goes on for 2 weeks because I still got a week left. Because I had access to this back on Tuesday when I did this recording, and it's Sunday now, so I still have. It looks like these are like bi-weekly resets almost, and you can switch to do any of them at any time. They all offer their own different rewards. Apparently they're repeatable as well, so you can do the same one multiple times, and they give you different rewards. In this case, if I can get to this final one here, it looks like it gives me a bunch of like end game type armor there to choose from. Although I'm too low level to actually use it there, which let's see, I don't actually have it here, but I already got like end level 80. Oh, never mind. I have the scepter here. I already got a level 80 scepter and a level 80 sword, which is, I think, in my bank at the moment. That I'm currently using the kind of I'm using transmogrify, which is basically just assume the appearance of those level 80 gear, but I'm not actually equipped in it right now with this sword. So I already am getting like a fair amount of level end game gear. I only got like the sword, a hammer, and one of the scepters there for like level 80. And if I get to the end of this like track there for like my PvP, I will get access to some dungeon armor as well. Let's see, there's other loot here. I would love to show more of this because there's actually like a bunch of smaller tiers that you can't really see here. Like every 5 or so, like it says right up here, 24, 40, like every 5 is what these items, icons, represent essentially, but you can get 4 more like sub traits, sub rewards in between there, which is where I've been getting those tombs to boost my level earlier. That doesn't show. But let's quickly get into the PvP. I'll do the unranked arena, because hopefully that'll be a fast queue and I can show you that. Currently, at the moment, there's only one type of game mode, but this weekend is a rare exception because included with the expansion, which they're doing a beta now thereof, there's like a second little game mode, which, what is it, there's called Stronghold, apparently. Conquest is like the main one that you have now, which is basically just King of the Hill, essentially. You have 3 points where you need to capture, but they have like a secondary objective to help accelerate your win or to help contribute in the battle in general. So this looks like it's going to be a standard conquest, so you could pick a map here. In this case, I'll take the Forest of Niflhel, yeah, that's the one I'm most familiar with, and all the players definitely vote, and then there's a random generation based on the votes to determine how likely it is to get what map you want. And this is where I've been having the most enjoyment with Guild Wars so far, because technically the theme of this 1 week to kill is basically centered around PvP, but free games in general still work. So this is the map here. We got a red team, we got a blue team. I look like I'm on the blue team there. These are the 3 objective points here. It gets a list on all the traits there. And the unique thing about this map is there's 2 like elite NPCs, like monsters that you can kill. They're represented by these icons, and they give you buffs to help empower you essentially for so long as you're alive essentially for like several minutes. So you lose a buff obviously when you die. It's kind of inspired by like most mobile type games like League of Legends, Dota, and all that. Probably more League of Legends type route, because Dota I don't think has like buffs associated with like their jungle minions. It's mostly gold, I think. So there's still 30 seconds to warm up, but this is essentially a warm-up here, so you can go out and just fight everyone if you want. You can switch your weapons there at will. And this is where the comboing comes in, because you can like combo your weapons mid-fight there. There is a bit of a cooldown if you are in combat, like a 5-second cooldown, I believe, when you switch weapons, so you can't just constantly do that. But that is where the dual weapons come into play, aside for the additional boost stats for like outside of the PvP arena. And of course, I'm Team Oathmaster. You do not want to be named after me. That is a bad omen, I'm gonna say. Ooh, and we actually get to take a look at one of the additional knight class. One of the new classes here is called a Reverend, which is gonna be introduced with the classes, so.
Hold on to your points! seize theirs.
But I'll talk about that afterwards. We're going to do a quick match here. It's going to be 15 minutes long, so normally it doesn't go on that much long.
Svanir's return.
It looks like I'm going to help this Reverend take on this minion here. So this is basically one of the giants here. You get a buff from him. I'll show that once we kill him. There we go.
Took the mine.
Let's see, and we got Aura Power, so 50 points.
You've seized the henge.
50 points for all stats, so I don't know how drastic that is, but it did boost my health like a little
bit. The keep is yours.
And they just killed the other jungle minion. So it looks like we're going to have a fight here in this back door area. Oh, never mind, they ran away, so it might be best to defend this objective. It looks like we're holding it just fine. Now here comes the real fun. Trying to hold them off there, because again, this is King of the Hill, so we don't need to fight them if we don't have to. In this case, we want to hold... Oh, that apparently was a necromancer-like type of aura. So... Let's see, I'm trying to get rid of my target. I'm going to switch weapons there again to melee and try and hold them off this point. And now I'm just going to pop my defensive cooldowns. Like I said, one of my abilities make me immune, so I can stall with it. I'm going to try and heal, but everyone's here, so I may have to play a little bit defensive. And... One of the features that they have included is like a roll mechanic where this little yellow bar might be a little tricky to see, is it fills up there, and if you activate it there, you are completely immune for the duration of your roll, which is an interesting mechanic, a bit odd, but it works. And so far, I have been surviving. Come on. Okay, he's been knocked down. What happens there? A little icon appears to kind of get you get an option to finish him off, essentially, there, which you can see this player channeling there. So you get like a last stand type of fight. If I get knocked down, I can demonstrate personally, but I'm going to try and fight for my life there to kind of accelerate this battle. So, because I think already the fight is dragging a little bit long. So I'm going to try and show that there. Let's see, switch weapons, go in. Oh, this is a minion, so a monster, so I don't want to fight him anyway. And there's our necromancer right here. Gonna drop a little ore on the ground to punish him for staying it. I'm gonna buff myself, use my immunity, and refresh. And there, okay, here's me channeling the effect here to kind of execute him. There, execute, I got points for it. And you get a nice little visual effect there, which is actually a cosmetic thing as well you can purchase or unlock to kind of like have a banner that on top of the victim's corpse essentially for every time you successfully execute them. But it is technically a last stand where they unlock a couple abilities that they can use to try and keep themselves alive and fight back.
The chieftain has returned.
But so it doesn't look like I'm going to actually show that there unless I deliberately get myself killed. So, for the sake of the video, I might do that, but I'm going to try and put up an effort. So I'm going to heal myself, going against the ability there, and we're going to finish them off there, although this is overkill. You can execute them if you wish. Ah, there we go. I wasn't paying attention, but this is the last stand fight. You can access the 4 abilities based on your trait. And whenever a player dies, whether it's from you or someone else, you get Rally, essentially. So basically, it allows you to have a chance to keep on fighting if you can successfully kill someone. But that was a quick, brief example of it there. And I'm going to try and deter him there because I don't have a lot of health. I want to trying to get out of combat so I can passively regen as opposed to use my abilities. Because you regen your health quickly if you get outside of combat, which I would like to do, but it's not happening here. So I think I'm going to have to heal up. But it looks like they're all respawning. We are near the point there, so I'm going to have to kind of hold them off there best I can. And let's see, I have a teleport ability. And I'm gonna have to try and stay alive, but I don't think it's happening this time. So I have an ability to knock him back temporarily. I have a channel beam effect as well as two other abilities. Ooh, and I knocked him down, so there might be a chance for me yet. Nope, I'm dead. They just straight up just wounded me to death instead of the execute, so you could just traditionally kill him normally with abilities AoE if there's too much fighting going on to successfully execute, because you leave yourself exposed, vulnerable a little bit, because you can't use your abilities while channel it. So if you can't do that, you can just damage him down while killing everyone else essentially. And so far this fight's going really well. I can be happy about it. Because it goes up, normally these conquest modes go up to 500 points, so we need another 100 to win this match. So, let me just get in there, use up all my cooldowns. There, I teleport on top of him. Gonna use my heal, and it looks like he got knocked down, so. Good, we're gonna take two of them out. Try and execute. But like I said, they have a few abilities to try and combat if they wish. There, got two kills. I did use one of my defensive cooldowns to finish it off because they were starting to hurt me a little bit. There, it looks like we are slowly stomping away. And this guy's about to be another victim. And there's the rolling effect there. It just evaded and made him immune. There, another kill. Starting to get on a rampage a little bit there. So maybe Team Oathmaster isn't a bad omen. And every time you kill a player, you get additional points as well. As well as killing those minions we did at the very beginning of the match also contributes points as well. Heck, even some of the effects give you additional points.
Your team for like, victorious.
Like, one of the buffs, I believe, you get an additional 3 points for each player you kill while you have the buff. And there's the tier complete by... There's the progress track I was mentioning. Like, it shows 4 sub-tiers, which you can get different effects there, including the Tomb of Knowledge. I just don't know how to activate that to actually take a look at it outside the battle. But that's where I've been getting my Tomb of Experience that I use. And of course, as you upgrade there, you get your rewards up here above the minimap. In this case, I got a Champion's Bag, and I complete the tier, so... Oh wait, I don't want that. And that gives me reward track, so let's see. Open this up, that gives me more bags and our stuff. So you get lots of items here. In this case, I got a level 20 sword for my PvE, which is actually kind of nice. I kind of wish it was a two-handed sword, but this is a regular one-handed sword. We got a trident, which they're actually underwater. I haven't got to experience it yet, but there's underwater levels and abilities and gear you can use as well. For like underwater fighting, so there's that as well. There's a torch, which is an offhand type item, which this has emphasis on fire. It's a wood torch of ice, which kind of is counterintuitive, but I'm not gonna contemplate on that too much. But this is a good way to get gear as well if you are into the PvP. It tries to roughly give you gear around your level though in this case, because I've been getting mostly level 14 type gear, but now that I'm high enough level, I'm getting a bunch of level 20 stuff, so it does work out well in that sense. And there's a spear as well, which is another underwater item. But this is Guild Wars 2 in a nutshell. I think I spent about, was it? With the video so far, I spent about 13 hours, I think, total there. Most of that is kind of like studying and understanding the nuances to it there, the crafting, the abilities, the traits and all that there. But I spent about half of that, the actual combat and leveling type experience on PvP, and the other half was doing the PvE and like the soloing and story type stuff to give you a good sense there. Because you do not get XP in the PvP itself. You get a completely different like rank altogether, which this progress bar switched to like my PvP rank, which is this. So you don't get actual levels technically from this, so you have to get those tombs if you want to effectively level up in here. So it has not been as effective leveling up for me in that sense, but those tombs will become more valuable as I get higher level, probably due to the fact that the leveling process is going to take longer and longer. And I ended up getting like a grand total of like 8, maybe 9 of those tombs of experience. Most of them a few of them, like 3 I used when I was like level 4 or 5, so they may not have been the best use. So I probably could have been higher level at this point in the game if I have hung on to him, so do keep that in mind as well. But this is Guild Wars 2 in a nutshell. I'm going to log out and just show you all the other stuff here. One important thing I need to keep and make note of is that when you first start up your account there, you get to choose a server there on your free as a free account, but once you select it, you cannot pick another world, so that is very important to note. If you are planning to play with your any friends that you may know in the game, so be very wary of that. Make sure you're on the same server. And of course, on the free account, you only have access to two characters, with three being unlocked if you were to pay for the expansion, because this is technically the actual vanilla version, I guess, the classic version, which everything is free for you, so you're not really hindered too much, it feels like, aside from maybe these player accounts and the server transfers, it feels like. But to get the expansion will cost about $50 US, and there's additional features, which I guess is to kind of go in nuance with the microtransaction type stuff. But a lot of the microtransaction stuff is like boosters, cosmetics, dyes, unique dyes, and all that there. Does it even show on here? No, it doesn't. Maybe that's something I could have looked at before. But this is pretty much it. I'll quickly show off all the characters in that. There's five different races that I mentioned. There's the Char, which I'm using. There's the Norn, which are like, they're really towering, like I assume Viking type of characters. There's the humans, Ishora, the tiny intellectual type of characters, and the Savari, which are, I guess, are closest to elves. So you pick your race there, you choose your gender, and of course, even though despite the looks of different character there, you can choose any faction, race, or class you want to be, I believe. I have not noticed anywhere I was locked out except for the Reverence. Reverence. I'm just gonna stop trying. Which you unlock when you get the expansion, essentially. So I don't think that doesn't necessarily matter too much. You got your three casters down here, the Mesmers, which are the illusionists, kind of. Elementalists, which are like mages, necromancers, straightforward. Rangers, which are like your emphasis on crossbows, like in woodland, they probably have like the beast pets. You got thief, which are rogues, engineers, which are like use emphasis on grenades and rockets. Well, not rockets, but like grenades and that. Warriors, which are like barbarian type creatures, all physical prowess. And the guardians, which like I mentioned, are the holy knights, paladin like type of creatures. And I don't know what the revenants are. There, I actually got it eventually. And actually, let me just quickly go through the backstory. You got your limited cosmetic type stuff. I'm not gonna talk about that too much. You get, and this is how you develop your personal story. You choose your different items there. You get that item for like, as your starting equipment there. In this case, I took the visionary helm, and it has like a little backstory referring to it. Let's see, like this shoulder here is like a famed hero returned to it to give you these shoulders, so adds a little bit of backstory here. Trouble may follow me, but I use my dignity, charm, and ferocity to overcome it. I am proud to be, this is where I chose Blood Legion for my character I was choosing there, but Ash Legion is actually like the Rogue Association. They do stealth and search and refuge, and they're Iron Legions who is the engineers, essentially, and the Blood Legions are the frontline fighters, essentially. So, actually, let me try and choose a different, see if that varies. Iron Legion? Nope, all of them are essentially the same. So it doesn't change your who your bodyguard is or colleague is. So it told me to sire that the soldier that sired me is a loyal soldier. A source honorous gladium. So my father turned his back on his. Oh, that's what I chose. Honorous Gladium. So now he's an Honorous Gladium with no respect for a chain of command. So that is where the storyline kind of differs for me there. Because I chose Honorless Gladium. And here you type in your name, whatever you wish. If it's available, of course. So you have to consider that. And that is all I think I had to show of Guild Wars 2. So it has just been announced free to play, so hopefully everyone's encouraged to give it a try at the very least. So thank you for tuning in for this pilot episode. I think it's gone a little long there, so we'll have to tune it back a little bit, but thank you for watching.